On the agenda, we're gonna we're gonna have the IMAs, the wastewater, go first. Who will be presenting?
Well, it'll be myself and John Maravich, but I believe we were gonna do this in executive session since it's a legal update.
So should we?
I mean, if we wanna get, there's not a whole lot to discuss tonight. We don't, unless, but if you do wanna ask more, you know, pointed questions, then yeah, we should go on executive session.
Okay, so what's the consensus? Do we go on executive session first or? Okay.
I apologize, I have another meeting, so.
Okay.
Hi, this is Frank. I can just come over to the council chambers to join you there if it helps with the Zoom situation.
Go into my office. Because I can't put the attendees on hold.
So we'll have to excuse ourselves from chamber. Okay. So let's proceed.
It's one of the more interesting questions. You have something you don't think about when you think about what you guys do. But
okay, thank you everyone for being patient. We're going to reconvene and continue with the agenda for this evening. So I have here Berks Nature. Mr. Lloyd will be presenting.
Yes, thank you. Good evening, everyone. Larry Lloyd from Berks Nature. I'm here to talk about the Grimm property.
Mr. Lloyd, we can't hear you.
Uh-oh, I'm unmuted. How are we doing?
Could you turn up your volume, Larry?
Can I turn up my volume?
That's good.
That's good? Can you hear now?
Much better. Thank you.
Okay, I'll get a little closer. Larry Lloyd, Berks Nature, here to talk about the two properties of interest. The Grimms had contacted Berks Nature about their 0.18 acre property on Hessian Road that's immediately adjacent to the Mineral Spring Park. This prompted me to contact Marcia Goodman Hinterschitz because that's her district.
And lost you again. Also,
What's that? Hello?
Larry, could you point your camera down a little bit so that we can see your full face?
Oh, I'm sorry. Since I was having trouble sounding, I got too close. Okay, I'm going to stand back a little.
Thanks.
Sorry about that. So I contacted Marcia Goodman Hinterschitz, that's her district, and also contacted Kyle Zieber from Public Works to run the idea by them about accepting this property because it would be a good addition to the Mineral Spring Park and a good buffer from the residential that's along Hessian Road. And then after speaking with them, contacted Frank Dambowski, which brings us to that property on the agenda. The other property on the agenda is in Kumru Township. It's not in the city of Reading, so I was unable to contact any of the council person. So I contacted Kyle again, and then also Frank. This is a wetland property and a floodplain that was part of the Angelica Creek ice dam operation that formerly included the Angelica Creek Park. Berks Nature, of course, is managing the floodplains and wetlands in Angelica Creek Park. So we thought we'd be a good fit to own this property and manage it outside of the city in the same watershed in the Angelica Creek. And Berks Nature is willing to, part of the conversations with all involved was Berks Nature is willing to pay for the transactional costs and the development of the deeds and the recording. And all this would be subject to review by the City of Reading solicitor. Are there any questions?
Marcia?
And just to be able to say, I felt the proper process was followed when Judge Grimm did contact me about the property. I referred him back to the city, and then it was picked up by the solicitors and such for what needed to be done. And that is an undeveloped piece of property that's on a steep bank that really is actually appears to be part of the park, no, it is privately owned. The other piece recorded with Angelica is it makes perfect sense to have that piece of land that is very adjacent to what Burke's Nature currently operates to be part of their land. And I just want to put out a shout out to Burke's Nature for the excellent job they've done in controlling their properties, including my backyard property. Never really been outstanding. Thank you, Larry.
Thank you.
Does anyone else have any questions? Donna?
I think actually Louise had called first and then I referred them over to you and also had shared an email with Michael when you first came on board regarding that.
That's right.
So it was, I was glad they I noticed it from the actual date. I think it was like December or something. So I was glad they thought of the city and they thought of the alternatives for that property, for the properties, which really made sense. So that's it.
Thank you, Donna. And I see it's on the agenda for this evening for passage. Thank you, Larry, for your presentation. Does anyone else have any more additional questions before we move on? Okay.
I have a quick comment. Can you hear me? There's a little.
Yes.
Okay. Sounds like there's a little feedback. Okay. Just put it in perspective. This was a very strategic move because Burke's Nature is in a position to really do more for environmental sustainability stewardship. So the property over at Angelica is 12 acres. And just keep that in mind that that's a holding that we're responsible for. And a few years ago, we had illegal dumping there. We had to clean up, I think, I'm looking at a report here. I think it was like dozens of tires. So we want to reduce our holdings outside the city. That's really key. And this property that we're obtaining is 0.1 acres. And you ask yourself, well, that's not very large, but it's a critical piece of property because it's adjacent to Mineral Spring Park. And as we look at the Mount Penn Preserve, the whole area, it's in our best interest to have as much holdings there as possible, even if it's a small parcel. You don't want to leave anything untouched. So this is a really win-win situation. And we're really appreciative that Burke's Nature reached out to this proposal because we see ourselves, everybody, benefiting from this transaction.
Thank you, Frank. Okay, next, we're going to move on to the party. Nathan.
Now, can everybody hear me? So I guess we have a couple things on the agenda to go over. And you just want me to go?
Sure, go for it.
So the first thing is the resolution that was introduced back in March, or the ordinance that was introduced for line striping. So I'm just gonna quick give a little history because we have some new council. So just a little history on the line striping. The mayor's office took this initiative of introducing this concept of line striping. And it was they that also those 31 blocks that are in this pilot program. And this was brought about from numerous complaints from residents. People have been taking up two spaces with a car. And then when somebody comes home, they'll back up and they will then basically be reserving a space for somebody else and they'll pull in. And so we've received numerous complaints about this over the last couple of years. And basically what we did is we hired McCarthy Engineering. They're our civil engineering firm. They went out and conducted an as-is study of the 31 blocks. In the mayor's pilot program. The initial that there was 980 spaces, usable spaces in those blocks. After the evaluation and then maximizing parking, and still maintaining safety for sight lines, they were able to increase that amount of parking to 1,000 spaces for the same area. That's an additional 107 spaces, average 11% improvement. And we were just really excited about that because we didn't know how much it would yield, and it did. And so that's kind of the history behind the line striping. Or does anybody have any questions about it? Yes.
Melissa.
Thanks, Nathan. So somebody went out, and are these spaces going to be in between cars, since there's going to be more, like, it's already tight as is. So you're adding more parking spaces. There's still going to be space in between cars.
Yeah. So we're going to paint a line, and everything's laid out, and I think we sent over a copy of the proposal of all the diagrams. What we really discovered was there was a amount of inefficiency in what was out there. Like, one of the hydrants had, instead of it being 30 feet for the yellow curb, it was 75 feet. So there was all sorts of things like that. People were out, they painted their own yellow lines, yellow curb, white lines, all sorts of stuff. And so there's not going to be, it's just going to be like in a parking lot, right? There's not going to be space in between, but there's a minimum amount of space per space.
And another question, and how do you plan on, I don't know if it's in here already.
In the ordinance, it basically says, I think the 1st of July we'll start the program, and then it'll run, I think, to the 1st of October as the pilot program. So we have to get everything, we have to get the engineering crews out there to lay out all the markings. Our team will get out and stripe everything. So it's gonna, to get 31 blocks in between now and then, it's gonna take some moving. So, yep.
Chris?
What is the approximate size of each stall?
I think on here it's 8x20.
Thank you.
Yep.
Anyone, Donna?
I've seen several in my district that have already been done. I don't know if they were done at the request of, but I mean, there's whole blocks I've seen done.
Okay.
I was just driving through today. I'm thinking McKnight Street, maybe Wiser. I'm
sure. Okay.
But it looked like everything was much more orderly. Now maybe okay. That was done prior for some reason by the, you know, streets department, I don't know, but it seems the streets seemed a little bit more balanced.
Yeah, we haven't started any striping yet ourselves.
Someone's done it in some areas of my district.
Okay.
To answer Donna's question, over the years when we repaved streets, for whatever reason, occasionally that was part of the specs to put the white lines, but there was never, I don't believe, unless I'm wrong, the coordinated approach or effort of being strategic about this. When you look at the paper that Nathan provided us for our packet, you'll see that we picked largely urban dense areas where parking is most challenging. And, you know, it's amazing to me, 800 block of North 12th Street, 10 more parking spaces. I mean, do you know how much of a difference that's going to make in a neighborhood? I mean, in my neighborhood, even three spaces makes a huge difference, but you got a neighborhood making 10. I mean, and then in North 9th Street, there's another one, 15. And some neighborhoods, there's only two. In some cases, there's even. So we're not, at the most, we're not taking away parking spaces. So that's important too. We want to be contrary to what we're trying to do. But the mayor reached out to the parking authority and he felt really strong about this concept, because a lot of constituents suggested it, because they talk about adjoining municipalities. Well, they have it. How come we don't have it? They may be able to address it. So we went to the parking authority, because that's what they do. They would know best, and asked them, are you willing to help us, assist us with this pilot program? And the other caveat was, could you assist paying for it too? At this point, we're not contributing anything to these studies. and to these line paintings at the moment. So there's already been a lot of costs developed here. So the Parking Authority has been extremely collaborative with us, and I think this will go a long way addressing some of the parking congestions that we have. So the big thing now is to see how the pilot program works and really get citizens' responses, and to see if this is something that we want to do citywide. Because if it is, one of the things we can do to add to this is when we repave streets, because we have aggressive repaving street plan, we can also put those specs in the repaving streets. But we don't want to do anything yet until we know this is something that's going to work. So on paper, it looks that way, and we feel good about it. But once again, it's the trial program will tell us ultimately.
Marcia?
Yeah, and I appreciate the concept of a pilot program. Just a couple caveats. First of all, Nathan, I was glad you made mention of the fact that people are privately painting lines, because I've seen that in my neighborhood where they don't want anyone close to their cars, so they paint yellow lines where they don't really belong. So we have to be able to, in some way, educate people. And those lines may have to be unpainted, however you do that, by the city, because they are taking up space. My biggest concern, and it's more on the drivers, is I don't think people really know how to parallel park the way they need to. And a lot of very oversized vehicles are seen around the city. So I think it's going to be a challenge for people to have a skill, which you should have learned when you drove, but I'm not sure a lot of people even have driver's license at this point, to be able to see how it's going to play itself out. People being not even wanting to be able to go around a block all over the place. It's going to be really interesting to see how this affects, you know, just the traffic in the city and people being patient enough to back up, because it does take a couple seconds to parallel park correctly. And I just, it's going to be an interesting scenario. I don't know whether we need to send people back to driver school. It's also going to increase the number of dents, because people aren't mindful when they back up into, if they're actually clearing the car. So we'll see a lot more of that.
I do notice that when I do park between the white spaces and the white lines in Wyomissing or West Reading, I feel like there's more space because the person behind you, you know, they're taking a decent amount. So we'll see.
Thank you, Melissa. What is the cost, Nathan?
Cost for the whole thing?
Right, for this pilot.
So, I mean, just engineering and surveying alone, we already have over 20,000 into it. That's not including buying, we purchased 5 skids of paint, the machines to do it. And yeah, I don't have a fixed number that I could give you right now.
Yeah, when you get a chance, I'm just curious, you know, as we do this pilot and then we decide that this is something we want throughout the city, what's gonna be that expense, that cost? Thank you. Oh, and one last question for you, Nathan, on my part. How will community constituents be informed before this gets started?
We're going to work on developing an education plan. So obviously Facebook, website, we'll do a media release. We're probably going to do a flyer. Typically, we've done a flyer that you can put on the windshield or go door to door and hand it out to people as well. So 31 blocks, that was a big, big area. And we'll definitely give the media release, you know, so you guys can hand it out as well.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else for additional questions? So I guess we'll move on to the next part of your presentation. I think we're gonna be reviewing fees, right?
Yes.
Just have me put together in order of the amount. So I started with the highest and then went down to the lowest.
Did everyone get a chance to look at this? Did Jeff highlight anyone in particular?
No.
Okay.
And do you want me to give you just a quick highlight history of what we did here?
Sure.
So basically back in January of last year, we updated the fines for the first time since 2010. There had been no increase. And the big thing we did was we made a band of 12 ordinances and labeled them public safety, things that would directly and could directly result in the loss of life. So your fire hydrants, your crosswalks, blocking intersections, things like that. And that was made all the same price because they're all showing the severity of the violation. And there was a couple that were reduced, but everything else just kind of went up a smaller amount versus those 12.
I do have a question. So the yellow lines, right? The curbs, do they all measure the same? Because I know you have on here that's parked within 20 feet of crosswalk at an intersection. Mm-hmm. Are all the yellow lines clear? Do they all measure the same?
No, I mean, clear from our measurements, we've seen that things are all over the place in terms of what's on the street. And that's why we, you know, in our enforcement right now, this primary focus is on the public safety things and not on line striping. Or, I mean, the yellow curb enforcement piece, unless it's a safety issue.
Anyone have questions? Go ahead, Melissa.
Are we going over these just because, or are there? Why is this only?
Council President requested.
Oh, just to see it?
Well, I think we also had some constituent complaints about the fines and how outrageous the amounts seem to our constituency. So this is why Jeff put it on the agenda, so we can go over, because we went from, I think we increased by $10 for the most part. Am I correct, Nathan?
Yeah, and just, you know, the ones that went up $10, if you take that out over the amount of years, that's an average of a 2% increase per year from the last time it was increased.
And then just for clarity again, Nathan, did you say that you're not focusing on the yellow curb, but focusing on public safety?
Yeah, I mean, we're just focusing primarily on those 12 public safety ones. And, you know, we're never not enforcing them, meaning we never run out of them and have time to go do other things that are less egregious. So we're always doing public safety.
And I understand that. And I guess I just get concerned with having just consistency, right, with what we have written in terms of these violations and what actually is taking place.
Sure.
With our streets, because I know there is inconsistency with the curbs, even with the fire hydrant, the 15 feet. I don't think that it's clearly identified for our constituents, and I'm not sure how what everyone else here thinks.
What I see with fire hydrants is so egregious. I mean, I'm almost, and I know that's terrible, but when there's a fire and they have to go through the windows of a car, I don't really care.
Yeah.
You know, I just think, I don't care. In every place where there are cars and streets, you can't park at a fire hydrant.
Yeah.
And I mean, people are just, they're just being disrespectful. And just basically, I can't say the word, but basically that, you know. So I would rather see a much shorter, I don't think $100 is enough. I'd make it $200 for a fire hydrant violation. In a city like we have that's so densely built up, I think $100 is nothing. I'd make it $200 in a heartbeat. I just think it absolutely should be. There's no excuse for it. There's no excuse for it.
Marsha.
Yeah, and I concur with Donna. If you look at what the firefighters have to do every second, even if they do crash through the car, the time that it takes to do that, we go get the hoses in the correct position, it just doesn't happen. I was fortunate there was a fire on our block. that no one was, as they usually are, parked in front of the fire meter or fire hydrant, because there was the truck there getting ready to attach the hose. But it's been more of a that people park there. The question I had for you, Nathan, when we look at these fines, would that be only happening like within what time interval? Let's say the person consistently stays in that same space. Do I pay and refine them, or is it just once and done? Or how does that happen?
So typically we're only allowed to issue a new citation every 24 hours. I think the only exception in here for meters at an expired meter, you can do it hour.
And then you're doing the ticket list, so people might not know being there for a couple days that they might be getting that huge bill for illegally parking, am I correct?
The fire hydrant we put on their windshield.
Okay, but the other ones are mostly done paperless, right?
As of now, the only ones we're doing paperless are the sweepers.
Okay.
And the double parkers.
Okay.
Donna?
I'd like to move forward working with Michael to increase this, to introduce an ordinance that would increase the fee for parking within 15 feet of a fire hydrant to $200. So I would like to move that forward. I think it will send a strong message to people, and I hope you guys took it away when people are that disrespectful and putting people's lives at risk. And the case, it's just, we can't have a city that's this densely built up. So I would like to introduce that at the next regular meeting, Michael, if we can work on that. And there's no issue with that being pulled out of this separate to everything else, correct?
I mean, it's your prerogative as far as each individual offense.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to do that then. Thank you.
And Donna, if I may just, I've met with a lot of people who park in front of a fire hydrant. I've been told that it should be legal, that they'll move their car in time when they hear the fire truck, all of these excuses. And one of the things we're doing is we're partnering with the fire department. We're actually coming up with educational videos that we're going to be posting on our website and sending out, because some people don't understand it. It's not just the fire hydrant, but, you know, look up on Locust Street just the other week. You know, the bigger ladder couldn't get in because somebody's parked too close, not to the fire hydrant, but to the intersection. And, you know, we posted the video from Facebook the other week again of another truck that couldn't get in. And
ironically, where I live, which is a single family suburbanish kind of street, I've seen it on my street where, I mean, it stunned me that I saw it on my street where, and you guys know the, you know, it's the very end of the city, and you know, the lack of respect just stuns me. So, but I have less worries that, you know, our houses would go up than the situation happened on Marsha Street or with the Rohams, you know. But I just have zero sympathy for that. So thank you for ticketing when that arises.
Okay, anyone else? Well, thank you, Nathan. Thank you for speaking to us this evening. We're going to move on to the next item on our agenda.
There's still three more things.
There's one more. Oops. Sorry. Oh, we have zoning changes for public parking lots. I apologize. Go ahead, Nathan.
Okay. Do you want me to say anything or?
Well, I do think that there's probably going to be some changes coming from the community development staff and one of our consultants. I don't think they'll be dramatic, but I think there was some concerns, not with the what's being proposed as much as cleaning it up to make sure it doesn't have like a do collateral damage to other sections of zoning ordinances. I don't know if we want to revisit that a little bit when the city staff has had a chance to make their responses, if that makes sense.
Right, Fred, because we're going through multiple departments, the planning office, the public works department, and the police. So we're internally reviewing this request. And like Fred said, we're not dramatic, don't look dramatic changes, but there is some revisions. And this is a process that we're trying to do moving forward, that we have consistency. Because a lot of times when we change something in one area and we don't have other departments review it, then we'll find inconsistencies down the road. So that's one of the big things. We have an internal team from different departments review it, making sure, number one, there's consistencies, and then any suggested changes. So I believe that process is taking place this month. Once that process is complete, I believe both the city and RPA will present it to the city planning board and then the county planning board before council could adopt it. So that's my understanding of the process. I think, is that correct, Fred?
Yeah, and I think that we would be scheduling the public, a separate public meeting for the zoning council meeting.
Okay, so we're holding off on this then?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you, Nathan.
Sure. The next one is the proposed changes for section 800, if you want me to go through them.
Let's go for it.
Okay, so basically we've been, you know, starting last year, we've been kind of updating all the ordinances because a lot of them are out of date. And kind of what we run into in section 800 is there's some references to magisterial district justices and the criminality of parking. Obviously all of that was changed. So if you look at all the changes that are in here, there's nothing substantive or that is outside of our normal operating procedure that's changed in here. It's literally just going through and updating the language, making things civil, those types of changes. So I don't want to bore you and go through each one line by line unless you had a specific question, but that's kind of the history and what we're doing there.
Does anyone have questions? No? Okay. Then thank you, Nathan.
And then I'm sorry, the last thing I was, council president no, asked me to talk about or said that we would talk about the pool on South 14th and a half Street. Yeah. So I'm prepared to talk about that if you want to.
Is that the East Reading, East Reading pool?
Yeah.
All right, well then share a little bit with us, update us. Yep, thank you.
So basically we looked at it, we sent our civil engineers and structural engineers out to evaluate the site. There's a 218 foot retaining wall on the site that is in gross disrepair and needs to be 100% redone. And you should have received a packet that has the cost estimate in it from our engineers. The retaining wall alone is estimated at $500,000 to repair the whole wall. And for us to finish the top, basically what we could do is put in 63 parking spaces under our CPR program, which is citywide parking relief, and basically offer, you know, in a very dense residential area, off-street parking, as we're doing in the city. So the total cost estimates have come in for us at around $750,000 put that parking in. So that's kind of the history behind it. And that's our evaluation of the site. If the city wants, obviously the city owns the site, we do not. We would be more than willing to put the parking in.
And Nathan, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Frank.
Okay, and just to follow up, when the mayor took a look at this, you know, he did get some community input because we got messages at the mayor's office, and we did hear from a lot of people on what the best usage for that space is. So there were some good ideas. You know, there was thoughts of maybe a community center, ideas of a recreation facility. And while that's something we always want to promote and upgrade, we realize there's a park right up the street. We have Neversink. Pandora's not too far. There's going to be a spray pad there. So we had to look at it strategically and say, what is the best use of this land? And, you know, there's always been concern about uncontrolled private development there. And that's why we obtained this property. But as Nathan shared, there's a $500,000, how could you say, just to fix that retaining wall, if you can picture that. So the mayor did ask the RPA to take a look at this. They had an engineer to take a look at this. And as you know, we've only acquired that property for $500. We believe this was 63 parking spaces in that specific neighborhood, because we do have, that's one of the hot spots for parking. There's a lot of places in the city, but that's definitely one of them. We get a lot of complaints about parking issues. We believe this would alleviate significantly 63 spare parking spaces for adjoining blocks. And we believe that's best use of that property, because it really is a quality of life issue. And when the RPA owns it, or would own it, if that's something we want to do or council approves, we also know that the property is going to be well taken care of. If you've seen recently some of their other lots that have been, they've been upgrading them, keeping them in, you know, pristine condition as best as you can in a situation with parking. But so the mayor strongly recommends this. And something that we still have to work out things through legal, but the mayor wanted to get the council to see if this is something we should move forward on.
Marcia.
Okay. And this is right in the backyard, basically. First of all, have spent a lot of time talking to the neighbors, because I understand what their concerns are. You know, they aren't actually my neighbors, so I can speak to them. There is an equal balance between those that understand we need to have more parking spaces, and those are the folks that end up getting tickets for parking on the fire hydrant, parking in the intersections. And there literally is, I'll be lucky when I leave council tonight that I'll find a place to park within three blocks of my house. That's just the reality of how tight the spaces are, and I have a little car. I did spend time talking with folks about the cost of putting in a pool, because I think people like to beckon back to the days when we had the East Reading pool. That would just be phenomenal. I think estimates were done on that. I don't think the city has the capacity. So I think we need to look at a win-win situation and work towards improving Neversink Playground and making that capacity for use. That playground has not been renovated for years. It does definitely needs a spray pad. There's a lot of room up there that could be used better than it has been. So there's a lot of open space. It's just a matter of the city maybe coming back and looking as far as its park and rec plan, how we can better use all the space up in the Neversink Playground. And then I know some neighbors want a place for a community garden. I don't think that would parking lot. So we maybe need to look for another location for that. Touch all the bases. And again, I think when this is voted on, there will still be people that will express some concerns, because they really want what was in the past. And unfortunately, I don't know that can be returned to them.
Thank you for sharing, Marcia. That was kind of my concern, like the community input and their thoughts on the space. Quick question for, I guess, Frank. Are we leasing? Are we selling? How are we working this out?
That's a good question. And we'll have worked that out RPA, but using in circumstances like this, it's probably ideal to sell. However, we have the right of first refusal. So for some strange reason, 50 years down the road, RPA wanted to sell it to a developer or something, that the city would have first rights to that property. Because we can't, you know, you never know what the future conditions are, right? So you want to make sure we protect our assets as best as we can. So that's something we could put on the deed to be able to have some kind of rights to be the first one if we want that property back. But ideally, it's probably a simpler process, and legal will have to work this out with their solicitor, but probably to sell the property outright. It's in our benefit because of the cost insurance. We're trying to, as I shared with you before, of the Berks nature, if we can minimize our holdings, that's in our best interest. When appropriate.
Thank you, Frank. Anything else, Nathan?
I have a question.
Oh, go ahead, Melissa.
Were they able to determine how many spaces it can create? I don't know if you...
Yes, 63.
Sorry. Thank you.
Yep. Anything else, Nathan?
I hope not.
Yeah, okay.
Another question.
Oh, Marcia, go ahead.
Yeah, do you have an estimated cost for the spaces at this point? So or do you want to put that out here yet?
Sure. What we're doing with all of our CPR lots, right? Mm-hmm. We're trying to start them all around the $30 to $40 price. And what we have to do on each lot is adjust it based on demand.
Okay.
So that we have some lots that are still $30. And then we have others where there's a waiting list of 20 plus people. We've had to increase those rates, monthly. Yep. Yeah, but nothing is above 50. The highest one is at $50. But yeah. On average, they're starting right in the $30 range.
And the privately owned lot at 15th and a half street, I believe, is at $60 at this point. That's one of the reasons we stopped parking there.
Sure.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Okay. Thank you, Nathan. Appreciate your time and you being here with this to us.
Thank you.
So now we're going to get into our agenda review. Okay, so we have an invocation by Pastor Raymond Bland from Beginning Christian Life Fellowship Church. He'll still be joining us. Excellent. Proclamations and presentations. Who will be the foundation recognizing Greek Independence Day? Okay.
If they're not coming in, we'll just read it.
We're just going to, okay. And we have it here. So I can just give it to Chris. Okay. Okay. Commendation recognizing Anthony Orozco as Reading's Poet Laureate. Awesome. Great. And then we have the fire department swearing in. So who are we doing that? Linda. Okay. Do we have anyone signed up for public comments? Okay. However, if anyone comes in before 7, they can. Okay. Okay, so we have consent agenda legislation. We have an award of contract for the City Hall roof replacement phase 1 to Mid-State Roofing and Coating, 4088 East Main Street, Belleville, Pennsylvania, at the submitted price of $464,485. Anyone have comments on that or?
I believe Kyle's on the call, but basically he may be able to explain more detail, but the City Hall roof replacement, this is only phase 1. It's something that needed to be done for a long time. So the first phase, I believe, is to really protect what's already there before we install a new roofing system. But Kyle, I don't know if you want to weigh in there.
Yeah, basically that's the old section of City Hall. It's the Washington Street side. That's where we were experiencing a lot of leaks over the last few years.
Thank you. Anyone have a comment or a question regarding the matter? Okay, moving on, award of contract for the purchase of 2017 Statco Catch Basin Cleaner from Jack Doheny Companies, Northville, Missouri, for the total submitted price of $180,000. Jack Doheny Companies is the sole distributor for Stetco, and we have found no other companies that make a unit like this.
And Kyle probably can explain more about this, actually, this vehicle, but it's something we really need because the catch basin is particularly up at Pandora, Egelman's, it Bernhardt's, because that's still our property, though, even though it's Millenburg, requires more sophisticated equipment in order to clean the basins because they go down feet. Like it's a lot more than a simple have somebody with a shovel clean stuff out. But over there, a lot of rain over the last couple of years, without cleaning those basins, it creates, you know, could create more flooding and some more environmental issues. But I'll leave the Kyle about how this vehicle works. So I read a description. I'm kind of fascinated by it, but I figured he would know better about the equipment. So you kind of know what we're purchasing.
Yeah, this is a truck that we actually demoed about a year ago. And this is the same truck. That's why we're getting it a little cheaper. It's only has a few years on it, but it was a demo model. It has like a kind of a crane on the side where it can reach down into either a catch basin or a spillway or something like that, and it reaches down to 30 feet so that when we have obstructions in there, we can pull them out easily without having to try to put somebody down there or use a backhoe or something.
Right. So this is also a personnel safety measure because these things need to be done, but we don't be lowering people in the areas that may be unstable. Right. Have we had something like this before? I'm asking you, Kyle. Is this something new that
This is fairly new. Like I said, we demoed this. They came out and did some demos for us, and the guys were, it was a pretty impressive piece of equipment. And like you said, it's a big safety thing. So that's definitely a plus.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone have, yes?
For several of these, were these budgeted items that were included in the budget? And if they weren't, where is the money coming from?
Excuse me, I'm just looking at the agenda memo. Jamar, I will ask Jamar because on your memo here, I don't know if this is coming out of the capital fund or not. I don't know if Jamar, since I'm on virtual here, I'm not sure if Jamar's there, if you could speak to it.
What?
The agenda memo says that it's included and approved as part of the 2022 capital improvement.
There he is. Yep. Well, I answered that. Thank you.
Great question, Chris. Thank you. The next award of contract is for the purchase of a 2023 Ford E450 AEV ambulance to Specklin Emergency Vehicle Sales and Service, Scottsdale, PA, in the amount of $190,000. Specklin EV is a PA CoStars vendor, and the contract is reflective of the CoStars pricing.
And this is simply a replacement of a current vehicle that has 138,000 miles on it. And ambulances are something that you don't want to break down. So when a vehicle has that type of mileage on it, it's time to replace it. So we're replacing that older vehicle. And just like what was said earlier, this is from the 2022 capital improvement budget. So it's been budgeted and there's sufficient funds to pay for this item.
So yes, to answer the question that just came up, this is a part of our annual vehicle purchase for the EMS department division.
Thank you, Jamar. Would you like to add?
Oh, sorry. No, just if there are any questions, I could answer them if need be.
Anyone have additional questions? No? Okay, well, thank you. We'll move on then. The next award of contract is for city park improvements to Empire Services, Reading, PA, at the submitted price of $843,100. The project consists of the removal or pruning of trees, understory clearing and grubbing, provision of earthwork, asphalt paving, walkways, porous asphalt paving, okay, segmental block piers, landscaping, installation of modular play and swing structures, benches and safety service mulch, and all related work.
So this is, as council's aware of, we're making significant investments in City Park. We're working on a spray pad and some new playground apparatus. But in order to do that, we also want to be able to not just improve the area where we put these playground apparatus, but everybody's probably pretty much familiar with City Park. When you go through City Park, you certainly know that we need to really, you know, start the trees need to be pruned. There's some stuff that has to be addressed. So we want to make sure that the environment around the playground structures are also brought up to date. Safety issues, you don't want just branches laying around. And so it's significant cleanup of City Park. And if you're familiar with the walkways, you know, there's been some flooding over the years because the drainage is all clogged up. So all that stuff's going to be addressed. So when we put these playground structures, also the landscape around it and the environment around it is consistent with the upgrade. And a lot of this has to do with safety.
And this will cover the entire, this is specific to the play area.
Well, there's other parts of the project. This is just one spades of it that's coming from the capital budget. This is part of a multi-phase project because we're looking at it. We're putting a spray pad there, and I believe an all abilities structure. So there is multi-phase here. But if we're going to do all those upgrades, I think it's really important that the landscaping around those areas are brought up to standard, right? And you don't want, you know, branches falling out of the tree or just stuff laying around. It requires an overhaul. So that's what Empire will be doing on our behalf.
Did you want to add something, Jamar?
Just a clarification. This part of the project is funded by CDBG. There will be another part of capital coming shortly.
Anyone else have questions? Melissa, I saw you had your hand up.
Is there any, do we have a date? Anything?
On a completion date, we can get that for you. I mean, we'll have an update for council. I think it's on the agenda going over all the community development projects and capital projects. I believe there's going to be an update in the near future on where they all stand because we do have goals. And we do have timelines, but as you know, they get adjusted because of various reasons. So instead of me giving you a rough idea, I feel more comfortable giving you an accurate answer by being able to provide that information for you later.
Thank you.
Anyone else? And as we're phasing into other areas of the park, I just want to throw something out there. I have a wish list for City Park in front of the show. I'd like to see an ice skating rink if possible. So I'm just putting it out there until hopefully we can find funding to do something like that. There used to be.
Okay. See? Can I?
Go ahead, Marcia.
Okay. And I really appreciate your interest in that. I also, because of this being in my district and becoming intimately familiar with all the environment around City Park, it's going to be a real challenge. We have a lot of water issues there because it is a wetland. It has caused problems to the band shell. My priority at this point would be that we make sure that band shell is in usable condition, and it isn't at this point. I would, you know, when I say that, I mean that there are some problems with the restrooms in there. There is some problems with just the concrete around it. Have that looked at because that is a venue and sort of like prioritize the projects we want to have. The greenhouse is sitting, you know, with, I'm not sure what the plans are. So what I would propose doing is us maybe having a separate meeting with the community, getting public input to envision where we need to go with the various components of City Park. We have a good partner. It takes care of the monuments, but we are having significant problems of vandalism and that type of thing. And so I just think it's a separate discussion before we get into budget about this is our premier park here in the city. What do we do to really bring it up to what it used to be? And then maybe we can look at where the skating rink might go. An area that was a water retention area, basketball courts are now. Okay, Don, I think you're probably familiar with that from your knowledge of the history of the city. So they put the basketball courts on top of what was formerly the skating rink. Yeah. Interesting history.
Wesley?
Yeah, I'm biased, but I think the basketball takeover as well.
That is on the to-do list. That's part of the cap.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, so we'll move on to E, resolution for the purchase of one 2022 Ford Transit Prisoner van. With a 5-year, $75,000, a 5,000 mile warranty from Whitmoyer Ford Inc., Mount Joy, PA, for $80,375 through CoStars and funded by the Capital Improvement Fund.
Chief Trinelli can answer any additional questions for that request. He's on the call here.
Yes, that's the report. I replaced one of our prisoner transport wagons that was due to be replaced this year. Obviously, we're seeing a lot of the supply chain issues, so we were able to locate this one that meets our needs and is within the what the expected cost would be. And that is complete on the street cost. There's no additional cost associated with putting that vehicle in service. It'll have all the lights, sirens, radios, and computer equipment we require, including our camera system in the area where we transport the prisoners.
Does anyone have any questions? Chief, typically, how long do these vehicles last?
Our patrol wagons, we usually will get anywhere between 3 to 5 years out of them, depending on how often we're able to rotate. We're able to rotate that are in service, typically at any given time. So if we can rotate them back and forth, then back and forth, one comes down for an extended period of time because of mechanical issues, then obviously that lifespan is shortened.
Thank you, Chief. And one last thing to the administration. I meant to ask earlier. So what do we do with vehicles that we replace? What do we do with the vehicles? I'm curious.
Kyle, please go ahead, Kyle.
Yeah, when we usually trade them in, if they don't have a lot of trade value, or if we want to use them kind of as a backup vehicle, we'll keep them around a little longer. And then ultimately we'll have an auction. We had one 2 years ago, I believe it was now. So every couple of years we'll have an auction.
And does that come back into the fund, or where does it go? General?
That comes back into the general.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so that takes us then to the administrative report. I'm going to assume, Frank, you'll be.
Yes.
And then our auditor, Maria, you'll have a report ready. Great. We don't have any direct boards, authorities, or commissions. So then we're going to move on to ordinances for final passage. We have bill number 29-2022, amending 220 fund 43, city facilities construction fund budget. Is providing an amending the okay. It's pro, go ahead.
Sorry.
Thank you.
This legislation is to create a budget appropriation for the sidewalk replacement program. That's a project that council set aside funding some years ago. It's been restricted under fund balance for its purpose. That program is moving forward this year for activity. So we needed to create an appropriation to account for expenditures.
Adding 400,000.
We're not adding, we're creating an appropriation of 400,000.
Okay. So how should this read? Amending the 2022 Fund 43 Cities Facilities Construction Fund budget is creating
to create an appropriation of $400,000 for the sidewalk replacement program.
To create an appropriation of $400,000 for the sidewalk replacement program.
Mm-hmm.
Be paid by a budget amendment in the city's facilities construction fund budget. Any questions? None? Okay, we're moving along. Bill number 30-2022, authorizing the mayor to accept land donated by the Honorable Arthur E. and Louise C. Grimm, 29 Hessian Boulevard in the city, and conveying a city-owned undeveloped parcel on New Holland Road to Burke's Nature. We had Mr. Lloyd present on this item. Any comments, questions? Are we good? Okay, that takes us to bill number 31-2022, amending by eliminating chapter 23, part 2, Penn Square Commission, chapter 396, Parks, part 2, Penn Square, and the permitting process, which is inconsistent with chapter 576, and reserving part 2 for future use. Yep, go ahead, Marcia.
I was just going to say that was explained to us at a previous meeting as being logical to happen.
Yes, Donna.
It's essentially a housekeeping situation because the components of a Penn Square Commission no longer exist. So it's simply deigning what has already been in. Yeah.
Thank you. And then we'll have introduction of ordinances. And will Mr. Butler be reading them this evening? Go ahead, Wesley.
Yes. Oh, you read them now?
Sure.
Okay. Okay, so we have
A, ordinance amending city code chapter 26, part 12, event and public gatherings by making revisions to the special event application process and the corresponding section of chapter 200 schedule for special events.
Do we need to, any comments or questions on that before we continue, or we'll have time to discuss next week? Okay, let's move on then. Thank you.
Oh my gosh.
I'm on, I gotta be now. All right. B, ordinance the 2022 general agency fund 31 to reflect the appropriation of funding in the amount of $152,500 for the lead hazard control program. The Community Development Department Property Division will be managing the Healthy Homes Initiative Program, targeting households with six years old or younger children and have been diagnosed with elevated blood lead level. The presence of lead in a child could cause developmental challenges medically found to have a measurable concentration of lead in their blood.
Go ahead, Jordan.
It's part of the grant that the city received last year, and again, creating an appropriation so we can begin activity under that grant.
Any comments or questions on that? Do we, as to when, are we hiring staff for this?
I believe we're in process. Frank, do we have on hiring? Yes.
I'm sorry, are we in the process of hiring for the the volume's a little low, so I couldn't hear your question.
Are we hiring personnel for this lead abatement project?
Oh, absolutely. Johanny, I can hear you loud and clear, but I don't hear everybody else as much. So I apologize for re-asking the question. But yes, there are new positions that's already been approved by council when we had the position ordinance for 2022. But there are new positions. They're part of the collective bargaining agreement, and they'll be working under PMI, where we have lead specialist, an intake person, and then I believe a supervisor type of position. So yes, there will be three new employees or current employees that transfer over that will be managing this program for us. And we hope to have these positions filled shortly.
Now, isn't this a three-year funding? Isn't it a three-year contract?
Yes. That's a good question, because that came up in our negotiations with the collective bargaining. It is, and that's what happens, not the risk, but when you have a position paid for by a grant, it's something that the person who takes it on needs to realize that once that grant's gone, you're not guaranteed employment. Doesn't mean you won't have a place to go to, but you're not guaranteed. So it is a three-year program, and those positions at this point exist because of the grant. The grant doesn't exist, the positions don't exist at the moment. So after 3 years, I imagine that we'll take a look at the whole lead abatement program to see if we want to move forward and continue it through our own funding mechanisms. And we may be able to find other funding mechanisms because of the importance of this issue. So
I assume the goal is to extend the contract beyond 3 years to find the necessary funding to keep doing, to keep removing lead.
Well, right. We have to see if this is something that we can do successfully, which we believe we can. And we got to be able to see what we do in the next 3 years, how much impact it has. We do have an aggressive agenda on the amount of homes we're looking to remediate. It was provided in previous administrative reports. But it's a good question, but it starts the process, it starts a program, and like any program that's funded by a grant, the city would have to make a decision, do we want to continue this program, or do we allow it? And yeah, it's premature at this point, right? So, you know, a lot of programs that the grant runs out, the programs that the city continues to fund, or they find other funding. And those are things that we'll have to explore as we get the end of this grant.
Thank you, Frank. Anyone else? Any comments, questions? All right, we'll move on, Mr. Butler.
Yes, so we're on C, ordinance amending City 53, Part 3, mobile vendors making corrections and adding provisions for vendors at the pagoda.
Can we have a summary of that, please?
I guess I can take it and then Don can add to it. So first of all, there have been vendors over the years that have operated on the parking lot of the pagoda without getting their proper licenses and permission. Basically just park their vehicle there and such. After the opening of pagoda, the one part is to be able to have outside vendors that are local vendors that we would be supporting local business rather than the pagoda itself operating its own internal. And that will be a point that we're just getting open. Things might change in the future, but at this point, there really isn't the capacity to run indoor refreshment and such. So we know there are a lot of good vendors that have high quality, interesting kinds of product. So the point of this is to allow that to happen. And I think it also specifies that the Foundation for the Reading Pagoda would have some input into what vendors might be selected. No, Donna, if you have. Yeah.
Thank you, Marcia. Anyone for questions on that? No? Okay.
Now we're at D, ordinance amending City Code Chapter 23, Part 14, Code and License Appeals Board by adding mobile vendors appeals to the powers of this board.
And that's a partner ordinance to the prior.
So they go together then?
Correct. So someone that doesn't like the decision of the property maintenance office has the ability to appeal it to the code and license appeals board.
So we're adding the language.
Correct.
So great, thank you. Anyone questions on that? All right, go ahead, Mr. Butler.
Okay, E, ordinance amending the position ordinance by eliminating two for full-time ambassadors, leaving two at $20.87 per hour for a total of $41,600 per employee per year, adding six part-time positions at the rate of $15 per hour at 28 hours per work for a total of $21,840,000.
Questions, comments? I'm gonna, we'll have some next week to discuss. And do we have options as well for these positions? Frank?
I'm sorry, you broke up there, but you said.
Do we have job descriptions?
Yes, yes. The full-time positions have to go through collective bargaining. We do have full-time job description. Well, we have job descriptions for both part-time and full-time. We can provide those, yes.
And we'll make time next week to discuss. Thank you.
Okay. Then the last one we have F, increasing the salary of the $105,000.00 per annum and will buy monthly installments.
Questions, comments? Is this already allocated in the budget for 2022? I don't know if you heard me, Frank, or if Jamar wants to answer.
I'm sorry. I don't want to speculate, so I'll have to turn to Jamar. I'm thinking not, but I don't think there's a difference from what was been budgeted and what's being proposed. But it's only a few $1,000 difference, I believe. But if Jamar has something to add to that, feel free to, Jamar.
I don't.
Okay.
Is there a justification for the increase?
It was part of the mayor's negotiation. We interviewed three individuals that were all in in-house candidates, and through negotiation process for a final job offer, that was part of the negotiation process. And that number came up from what appropriate rate would be for a fire chief and for a size of this city. So we used some of that data, and it was part of the negotiation process.
Did you need to add something, Jamar?
There's a question
difference of 9,000 over what the country is.
Anyone, comments, questions? Okay. That concludes our new ordinances for final passage on the agenda. Then next we have resolutions. Quickly read them. Resolution number 69-2022, authorizing temporary parking regulation pilot program for the installation of parking stalls at prescribed locations within the city and parking requirements related thereto, a 90-day period pursuant to Chapter 576, Vehicles, Section 105, Experimental Regulations, effective July 1st, tabled at the last meeting of March 28th. And today we heard Nathan give us a briefing on that. The next resolution is appointing Patty Bell to the library board. And the next, followed by appointing Josephine Torres Boykin to the Equal Business Opportunity Board. I'm sure, yeah. Council, yeah, Marsha will have a few words to add there. And I think that concludes our agenda review for this evening. Time is 6:48. Will we reconvene at what time? 7 p.m. So we get a little break. Start at 7? Yes? Okay, great. Thank you for a few minutes.